टॉपिक फॉर द डे विल बी डेटा व्यू फंक्शंस।
So just one or two lines I want to say before we get started with the data wave functions. All of us, we usually use the data wave functions, but these are the functions which are newly introduced in 4.3.0, and some functions we have tried to cover because as you know, there are many, many functions. So we have like taken out some 24, 25 functions which we'll be explaining. So that's the plan about data wave functions.
Yeah, so to cover more on that, as we all know that what DataWave is, we are mostly familiar with. DataWave is a MuleSoft tool which can be used for transforming the data, and there are ample of DataWave functions that we all use on daily to daily basis to fulfill our business requirement. But in today's session, as Supriya mentioned, we are going to cover some unique and some impactful functions using which you can optimize your DataWave to the next level. Some of the functions are very latest. They are newly introduced in Mule 4.3, and some of them are already there from Mule 4.2.2. But our goal is just to bring all those unique functions in front of you and provide the little glimpse of all of their understanding, like how they can make the impactful. Some of you might know already, but yeah. So to cover, like we would cover these six modules in today's sessions: core, arrays, crypto, binaries, URL and values. So I would like to cover the first two modules, and then Supriya will take over to cover the rest of the modules. So what is core module? So hello, can you, yeah, sorry. So core module is something, this module contains the core data view functions, like for your data transformation. So we are using these core functions on daily to daily basis, like maps, map object, pluck, average, sum, z1, flatten, contains, distinct by. These are all the basic functions that we use in our projects on, these are the core functions that we use. But these four core functions have been newly introduced in Mule 4.3, which we want to walk through. So first one is entries of. So this is something we have prepared with a screenshot, like how this function will work as per the requested input and what will be the required output of that data wave script using the entries of function. So what this function will do, basically it will return an array of key value pairs that describes the key value and the attributes. So if you see on the left hand side, there is XML in place where we have one attribute which is X, and two elements A and B, where A is the key and true is the value. And if we use entries of, just entries of is a keyword and the bracket we have to give the input, and on the right hand side you'll see we'll have key value pairs which will have a key values and the attributes. So key is XML, value is something element A true B one, and attribute is something, if you found any attributes, it will return X, otherwise it will return null. So this is a functionality of this entries of function, which is newly introduced in Mule 4.3. This can be used as per a business requirement. The next function will be keys of. So what this function will do, this function is might can be used where you want to get all the keys from your JSON or from your XML. So this function will return an array of keys from your key value pairs within the input object. So on the left hand side, if you see in your input JSON, you have two elements A true and B one. So what are the keys? Keys are A and B. So looking at the data view script, you can see keys of payload, which is input data, and on the right hand side, the output is you have a list of an array of keys, all those keys. So if you want to do some, if you want to perform some transaction or perform some routing, perform some logic on the keys of the JSON, you can just extract all the keys using this keys of function, and you can work on the next logic. So this function will be used in that case. And the next function is very similar to keys of. If you see, the data view script is exactly same, but the what is the internal difference between keys of and names of? So names of also returns an array with the names of all the keys within a given object, but the basic difference that we have is the type. So the key of function defines or give provide the belongs to the key type. What array or what this a and b, the type is different, and the names of will give you the array of strings, so which will just give you the names of strings, and the keys of which will give the array type. So the type is different, but the functionality is going to be exactly same. This is the basic difference between keys of and names of. And the last core function which I would like to cover is values of. So this is very similar to keys of, where we want to extract the keys. In similar way, we can also extract the values from the JSON element or from the XML. So on the left hand side, looking at the JSON input, there are two elements A and B. So looking at the script values of payload, you can see right hand side, we have an array of values. So we can in some requirement where we want to play with the values only, we can use this function and go for the next logic. So these all functions can take a back role where we can avoid some shortcut, where we can avoid the long routes, and we can have these functions in place and can optimize our data view code. So this was all about core module. And the next module which I would like to cover, which is a very very useful, and because these arrays, mostly we are going to use data view on the arrays, JSON arrays or array type of payload. So there are 10 functions that we have came up, like these must be, this can be, can create a big impact. So the first one, this module contains actually the helper functions for working with arrays. All these play a big important role in simplifying your complex business mapping logics. And you all know, like all these functions, once you all got to know all these functions, you'll have a better understanding which function to use in which requirement or which scenario, and ultimately you can optimize your data view in that way, and you can also also reduce the complexity of the code in the best way. So the first function I would like to go with, the drop. So what drops will do, a drop function will do. So first of all, you have to import the module, what it block functions we were importing core module. You can see the line number 2 we are importing here, import a dollar from DW core arrays, because this is a function which is belonging to the array module. Now we have an input like where we have an array of 3 strings, Mariano, Leandro and Julian. And what this drop is doing, it is accepting 2 parameters. One is the input, another one is the n elements. So what it will do, it drops the first n elements, for now it is 2, and returns the original array when n is less than equals to 0. If you put 0 or minus 1, it will give you the original array, because we are not mentioning any number there. So for in the current scenario, we have mentioned 2. So it is going to drop the first 2 elements, which is Mariano and Leandro. On the right hand side, we can see the output is Julian. So in some cases where we want to drop some of the elements by number from the array, like if you want to drop first 10 elements or first 20 elements, so it start from first based on your n, based on the number that you are specifying, it will drop the elements and it will give you the left out array, whatever is left out. So in this way, we can use drop. The another function which is very related to drop is drop while. So what is the difference between drop and drop while? Is drop while is something, it will also start from the first iteration, but it will drop the elements based on the condition. So it will drop the elements from the array while the condition is met, but there is some logic, but it will stop the selection process when it reaches an element that fails to satisfy condition. For example, here we have kept drop while dollar is less than 3. So let's consider first 0 will come in the iteration, 0 is less than 3. So yeah, 0 will be dropped for sure. And then 1 will come in the iteration, 1 is less than 3 again. So 1 will also be dropped off. Now the next iteration will be 3. So 3 is less than 3, which will fail the condition. So it will not drop the element, and 2 and 1 will not be checked, because once the condition is getting failed, the other iterations are not going to happen. So this is the functionality of this rule. That's the reason it said drop while. So it's drop the elements based on the condition. So this was all about drop and drop while. Next will be the next function is from the arrays module, is every. So what it will do, it will just return a boolean value true or false on your particular condition. So it will return true if every element, as the name says, every element of the array matches the condition. This function also stops iterating after the first negative evaluation of an element in an array. So let's consider the first one on the 9th line. 1, 1, 1, and we are saying every dollar equals to 1. So there is every iteration of the array is 1, 1, 1, so it will return true. And the second one on the 10th line is all says 1. But if you see 13, 14, and 15 line, all the conditions or all the iterations are not satisfying. That's the reason we have false. So every element of the array should satisfy the condition, then it will return only true. Otherwise, it will return false. The similar example or similar related to that, every function is some function. So what some function will do? Every function is based on the AND operator, and some function is based on the OR operator. What it will do, it will also return the Boolean value true and false, but it will not check all the evaluations. If any one of the matches has been found in an array, it will return the true. At least one element in the array matches the specified condition. This function also stops iterating after the first element that matches the condition is found. So if you consider the first element on the 7th line, 1, 2, and 3, dollar mod 2. So 1 mod 2 is not a proper condition. 2 mod 2 is a proper condition. So it will not check for 3 because one successful condition has already been met. So it will return true by default. So it's totally work on the OR operator. And if you see on the line number 13 and 14, there are some errors because none of the iteration is getting satisfied as per the given condition. So this was all about every and sum. The next function will be first with, which is a very impactful function, which has been introduced in Mule 4.3 and can be used later on the later runtimes. So on the left hand side, you can see a JSON array, which is having three objects with name and last name field. So what this function will do, it will return the first element that satisfies the condition, or return null if no element has been matches the condition. Okay. So if looking at the database script, on 6 and 7 line, so a payload first with user index, where we are checking user dot name equals to Mariano. So if you see on the left hand side, the JSON contains two objects with name Mariano. The first object is also Mariano and the last object is also, but it is only returning the first one. On the right hand side, you can see the output. So it will extract only the first matched condition. If we are going in the requirement where we have to extract only the first element, if we have so many duplicate objects in our JSON and we want to go for first match, then we can use this function. The second condition, which is on line number 10, mm-hmm. is not getting satisfied, which because the name is Peter and we don't have any Peter name in the request, mm-hmm. hence it is returning as null.
So Sumit, I can see some of the questions. Sorry to interrupt you.
Sorry. Yeah, please.
Yeah. So I saw some of questions from Safi, read and write function. What exactly it mean by read and write function? For write function, someone has answered and I think he got it. But what about the read function? What is the purpose of read function? He is asking.
Read function. I have not explained read function.
Okay, so let me give you the answer. Okay, so read function is nothing but it will take a string, any input as a string and output as an object, like any application slash JSON, just opposite of the write function setting. So in the write function, you are expecting any type like JSON object or whatever, and you are expecting output as a string. So similarly, read function will take input as a string, and you can convert that string into object, corresponding object like application slash JSON or application slash XML. So just opposite of write, you can think of. Does it answer your question? Yeah, go ahead, Sumit. Yeah, I think.
Thank you, Manish. Mm-hmm. So yeah, it was all about first with. The next function will be partition. So as the name says, it will partition your input. This function separates the array into the elements that satisfies the condition from those who do not. Okay. So this function also generates the success and failure keys, if you see on the right hand side, within the output object. So there will be some two partitions, one success and one failure. Based on the script that we have written, we are checking on the condition is even. So looking at the array, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So all the even objects will come under the success key object, and all the failure ones will come under the failure key object. So it will partition your array based on your condition. So if you want to partition your array based on some condition, based on business logic, this function can be very useful in that scenario. and you can later work on the output on the JSON that you are getting in the output, like what to do further, whether you have to process the failure once or success once. Yeah, so this function can play a major role there. Next function.
One question. Yep. When you mentioned partition is an impressive function, so Benu, if you could explain me if you have used in this function in real life, so it will be great for the community at least. So if you can add two or three lines, like if you have, why do you think this is an impressive function?
Yeah, Manish. Yeah, thank you for asking that question. Okay, let's say we were upsetting any of the list. Okay. To any of the end system, be it any, be it NetSuite or Salesforce, we'll get the response in kind of flag. Okay.
Correct. So, success true and success false.
Yeah. So if at all, separate, you have to filter those records. Okay. Here, it will directly give you the structure out, the kind of standard structure directly to you. So yeah, that is something.
Okay, and based on the structure, based on the output, success and failure,
we can make it a standard, actually. Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. Thanks, Venu.
Yep. Thank you for picking that answer, Venu. Mm-hmm. Okay. So next function will be.
Venu itself has given the answer. He didn't ask any question, but he has mentioned partition is impressive. So I thought of asking why he's thinking impressive function.
Yeah. Yeah. I
multi-line functions in order to get the data. So here it is. Yeah.
Yeah. That's great.
Yeah.
The next function will be split at. This function is this going to split an array into two at a given position. Position is I'm highlighting this word position because if you see on the database script, users is input split at one. So one is the position. So position when I say, so Mariano is at position zero. In the array language, and Leandro is at position one. So we are giving the command like split at position one. So it will split your array into two parts, one left and right, not one and two, it will be left and right. So left on the output, you will see L object is being created, which is having an array of only one because we have commanded in that way, like it will split your array at position one. So based on the requirement, you can split your array if you know the position. Okay, and the next function will be very related to that, split where. So this is not related to position, but this will be related to some condition at the first position where the condition is met. So looking at the script, what we have, the condition is item starts with jul. So the only word which is getting started with Julian, the third at the third position or second position. So if you see, it will go iteration by iteration. So when the Julian comes into the array or the end process, so it will split, it will perform the split where operation at that place, and it will split the array based on the condition being met. So when you want to split on the condition, you can use split where, but when you know the exact position, like where you want to split and when you want, like at what position you want to split at, then you can simply use split at function. So these two functions are used to split your arrays at based on your positions and based on your condition. Next function is the next two functions are, sorry.
I'm just asking like any question on that, like anyone thinks.
Yeah, anything? Please.
Please go ahead. Like, so basically a split at will accept array and it will return pair of array. Correct.
Yeah. So both are going to return a pair of array. Left and array. Yeah.
It will be
all these functions which are coming under array module has to have the input as an array only.
Correct.
And the output can be either object or either array. That is depending on the function. The next function will be take. So what this take function will do, this is in totally opposite of drop function that we worked like initially. I have the first function which I explained. So what drop was doing, it was dropping the elements based on the number that we're providing the position. But take, what it will do, it will just the opposite of that. It will take that elements and it will drop the other elements. So this function is just the opposite of drop function. It selects the first n element instead of dropping. And if you see the screenshot, we are saying take uses 2. So it will take the 2 elements of it from the array. Drop uses 2 elements, and the left out array will be provided as an output. So this is just the opposite, drop and take. And the another function which was related to that is drop while. So this is take while.
One question. I won't take much time, but I have one question for community. Like, so
yeah, sure, sure.
Take will take input as a array, okay, and output will be also array, okay, that's right. And you are giving 2, so it will take the first 2 value, correct, Mariano?
Yep.
Okay. Yep. What if someone? I have a question for community, not for you, honestly. So what if I give 4, what value will get?
Yeah. It will not give you anything. Yeah. I just tried.
If it will not give you anything, yeah. So if you want, if you will give a less than 0, less than equal to 0, then you will get the original array in return. Oh, sorry, it will give you the empty array. And if you will, if you are giving more than 3 or more than 3, then it will give you the original array. So it's already handled by this function. It will not give any exception.
No, I think it should give nothing, right? Or if I give
no uh-huh. If let's say if I'm putting take users comma 4, so it will give me the entire array.
Oh, I was under the impression that it should return empty list or something, empty array.
No,
it will give you everything for take, but if you drop, then it will not give you anything.
Yeah. Drop is something we are asking to remove, or we are asking to drop the element. So if we say, if you use drop users comma 4, then we'll get an empty array in return. But if you're using take, now, then we have, if we use 3 or more than 3, we are going to get original array in return.
Yeah, because if we go this on the Lehmann terms of a take, okay, and if the take is not getting the proper input which it is looking for, then it will take everything. Similarly, if drop, it doesn't get the proper input, it will drop everything. I think from those basic things it is coming from.
I think it's totally depend on the length of the array. So here the length is 3. Okay. So if you're using 3, and if you're using more than 3, then definitely more than 3 is greater than 3 only.
Yeah.
So it should return the original array. That's right. That's how it's behaving. Yeah.
So in case of minus index, it will return empty list. You mean
0. Yeah, yeah. Even if you put -1, -2, it will give 0.
Okay. Makes sense.
Okay, yeah. And so very similar to that, take while, just the way we have drop while, it's take while. So it will not depending on the iteration, the heavy giving 2, like 2 iterations should get take or drop. But here we have to satisfy one condition. This opposite to the drop while function, it selects the element from the array while the condition is being met, but again stops the selection process when it reaches at that element that fails to satisfy the condition. For example, looking at the screenshot, here is take while dollar less than equals to 1. So 0 is satisfying that condition, 1 is also satisfying that condition. There's the reason they are being taken in the output. But as soon as 2 comes in the iteration, it fails to satisfy the condition, and the rest of the elements will not be checked further, because the condition has been failed once, so it will not check. But there can be some scenario. Let's say if you want to take out all the possible elements, then you can use simply filter. That is a basic core function that we are using in daily basis. Yes. You can use filter instead of take while. What filter will do, it will give you all the possible elements that are satisfying this condition. But if you want to check only that part, like one of the element is getting failed and the other will not get checked, then you have to use take while. So this is the basic difference between take while and filter.
Yes.
I hope I cleared this doubt.
While performing these DW operations, will there be any chance of getting runtime errors? Shafi, do you mean runtime meaning while running the code? Because if you're not using these functions in a proper way, the data view itself gives you the error, right? And in case this function, if it is wrongly used, then I think it will not give you desired output. But I don't think so, it will break. Please correct me if I'm wrong, Sumit.
Actually, these functions are being developed very smartly. So that's just the way. But just Manish picked one point, like if you put minus or if you put more than greater length of the array, so this function is being handled automatically and will give the desired output. Something is being written actually. So I don't think it will break something in the runtime or in the.
Yes.
Yeah.
But definitely, like if it is wrongly used or maybe, then you are not going to get the desired output which you are looking for. It will give you something else. Then you will realize and you have to come back and fix.
But if you are not giving the input as an array or this function expects an array, then you might face some runtime problems. Like this is not an array. This function needs an array as an input. Yeah. Then you have to put some conditions in place so that your code should not break in your runtime. Right. And then just to handle your scripts by using if, else, or when otherwise.
But based on the runtime. Generally, like being a developer, I would suggest that have a practice of doing the prefix. We also have one URL which is available, Sumit, which is wherein we can check the data view functions before importing, before adding it into the code. So that is really useful because we on a daily basis, we use it. So that's a very good experience.
Yeah.
There is another question from Vigneshwaram. Every main fail from my personal experience, if number of rows is more than 1,000, so I use for each loop to mitigate the issue. My error was. Vigneshwaram, about what you're talking?
I understood, Superior. Uh-huh. So this is something that due to the recursive function, so data will support recursive call up to 225. Recursive depth. So you can't call the same function in the data wave more than 250 times. Okay. So if you're calling the same function more than 250 times, then you will get a error called a stack overflow. So similarly for the flow reference. So if you're using flow reference and calling the same flow using flow reference, you will get the stack overflow error. So this is something that
the memory issue.
Exactly, memory issue. A stack memory issue. Yeah. So this is something that is a known issue and you have to design your specification or architectural based on the new design, I would say. So rather than going for flow reference, you can go for any point MQ or some other queue mechanism. Just push the data, take the data type of things. So this is very known issue, I would say. If you search a Stack Overflow anywhere in the forum, you will get the proper explanation. I have given the proper explanation in the forum also.
Supriya, are there any questions to cover more? I would like to hang take over to Supriya. You can take over from there and
I'll just stop my sharing. One more thing, is 250 mentioned in any documentation or blog?
It is mentioned. Let me find you and send it to you.
Okay, thank you guys. Thanks, Sumit. I'll take over. Just allow me to share. I think I'll open it in the slide format.
What is the next step? I didn't get.
There are some functions which I'm going to like. Few functions, not more.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then we can end this session.
Mm-hmm.
So we guys, we have, as I've mentioned rightly in the beginning of the session, that we did not cover all the functions due to time constraints, but whatever we felt is new, is not regular in the use, and good functions, that is something which we have tried to cover. Sumit has explained the core functions and bit of the array functions. Now I'll be talking about the crypto functions. Now the very function, very first function is a HMAC binary. Okay, so HMAC binary, then there is a HMAC width, and then there is a MD5. So according to the word crypto, you know that these functions are going to help us to encrypt the particular string or particular value. So I'll explain you HMAC binary first. So HMAC binary, on the screen, if you can see, this is the way to use the HMAC binary. We give content, we give a secret key, and then we provide the algorithm. For HMAC binary, the algorithm is HMCSHA1. That is the default algorithm, and that's the only algorithm. Hence, algorithm separately, you can't see that it is mentioned. So yes, as you know, content also we have to give in binary, the key also we have to give in the binary format. And this is the kind of output which we will get. And this is purely on the requirement basis. I will not say that this is getting hugely used, but yeah, somewhere you can have the requirement to use the crypto functionality. The another one is HMAC width. As I've explained to HMAC binary, it is similar. Content and the text is also content, and the secret key will be given in the binary format. But only difference is the algorithm. As I mentioned, the HMASHA1 is going to be the default algorithm. But apart from that, there are another two algorithms which you can use. So one is this HMAC SHA256, and then another one is HMAC SHA512. This is something which you can use, and this is the kind of output you will get. Very easy functions. Then there is a MD5. It doesn't have any algorithm. Okay, it's simple. It doesn't have it doesn't have any secret key. So it's a normal MD5 which we are using. Take any string and convert it, and this will give you such output, which is. So these are the three things which I have explained related to the crypto. And whenever you have such a requirement of encrypting just values or just the smaller keys and not the entire data, you can go for such a functions. Okay, next I'll talk about the binaries. Just four functions we have. Again, the concept is quite familiar and easy. You must have used it. Now you know that there are certain web services, REST services. In fact, I can say from my personal experiences, I have worked on such a things wherein people do not go for encryption, rather they do the encoding. Okay, so there is a difference between the encoding and encryption. So while doing the encoding, we generally don't provide any key, whereas in encryption, the key is required. So if you see the 2Base64 and then simply give your string which you want to encode, and this is going to give you such an output, and further in your flow you can use. One of the target system, they had the REST service and I was consuming their REST service. So they had a requirement that they accept the password only when it is Base64 encode. If you give the plain password, suppose the password is Supriya, it will not work. Supriya has to be encoded and then pass it to on their system. So 2Base64, then from Base64 is definitely opposite. Take the same string and convert it. It will give you the output back. The another one is 2hex. Here it is doing the binary 2hex formation. And here also you can paste some content, which is, you can see my binary is pasted here. So it is simply converting your string. And then from X is like different, like opposite from that, where it is taking hexa format and then converting it to the binary format. That is from X and 2X. Any questions in crypto and binary? Sumit, please check the screen, because I'm not able to check.
Yeah, there are no questions actually as of now.
Okay, because these are easy functions, but still there's an observation that sometimes it could happen that people are not aware about the functions and they may go for some lengthy processes. Hence our effort is to make you guys aware about this functions. So another last part is about the URLs. As I mentioned about the encoding, there are still some REST APIs, web APIs, they'll only accept the values when it is encoding. Also encode URI, decode URI. This is useful while creating any documentation, because documentation is something which you shared across. Okay. And in that you are not supposed to maintain the URI directly. So this is some functionalities which you can use. So as I said, encode URL, paste some text of yours, which is this entire URL. Entire URL. And this will get converted into the encoded URI. As you can see, there's this encode URI, and then again there is a function. This will give you such an output. Opposite to encode URI, we have a decode URI. Then you can copy the same encoded pattern. And as you know, I hope encoding is something. Just because it is not doing it with any key or with any other algorithm, what it does every time, even if you check the output after a year, it is going to be same, because it's a kind of a static values. an encode URI, like this is how you use it. You can paste your encoded URI and you can try to decode the URI. Then there is values. One is mask and update. I think mask is, again, there are certain services which are banking related or which are user related, wherein address, birth date, some important salary figures you don't want a customer to see. Hence, this is the way you can use the masking. Any field out of your request you want to mask, you can mention it here, and then it will give you the masking value. Also, this is a good practice when you're logging your data. I have seen that people log their data entirely. They have a provision of using the on-premises servers or maybe the Splunk or maybe any other thing. People tend to log their entire data. Instead of logging the entire data or try to remove the data and only pick a few values, we can go for such a thing wherein before logging the data, we can use a transform message. We can mask the specific field, and then probably we can log the data.
So there is one question from Vikas Signal. Never heard of HMAC, not sure where they can use. So these HMAC, these are the just algorithm, okay? So you don't have to worry about this. These are the cryptography algorithm where you will have private key and you just encrypt the input based on the private key. So what a type of algorithm you will use, that is called HMAC algorithm. So HMAC has a different algorithm, cryptography algorithm. So you don't have to worry about that. You can go through the Google or something. You can read more about the algorithm, what type of algorithm, cryptographic support. And there is one algorithm called HMAC. HMAC has a different set of algorithm, like 256 or 520 or 513, whatever, depending on the how much size of the key. So they are just algorithm, I would say.
Yeah. And anytime any requirement can pop up from anywhere, if you're working in a different project, I have had such a requirements wherein I have dealt with the encryption of the masking. Exactly. Mm-hmm. So it is purely based on the encryption. And like on day-to-day life, we are work on the core. In fact, I work on core functions only more. But we tend to forget that, DataWave is coming up with this also. And to be really honest, as part of a Mule, if you're a Mule community, Mule developer, please focus that how, nice development you can make, and, the code will be less redundant and everything by using DataWave in a proper way. I mean, you can really reduce lots of your efforts if you know whole and soul about DataWave. Okay, having said that, last function is about the update. Here, as you know, if any input is there, suppose we have 1,000 lines of an input, we are like converting, now there's a requirement of changing or updating just one field, okay? So that we can easily do using the update function. So here, if you say name Marino is there, update the field name with the DataWave. So the name value becomes from Marino to DataWave. Again, a very, very simple functions I've explained. But if you have certain requirements, instead of going for a complex things, we can definitely have a look about all the DataWave functions. There are different modules like core, values, binaries, encryption. We can definitely have a look before making any development progress.
Yeah, so there is one question from Vignesh. Can we mask data can be decoded by some function after logging?
So basically, he's asking about unmasking data. So actually, mask function is doing now is just replacing your current input in ***, right?
Yes.
So there is no unmask feature as such available, but there we can't decode that mask data with this function of mask.
We cannot.
There is no unmask
function. If you have such a requirement, you can propose this to your client that instead of masking, we can go for encryption in that case. Okay. If there is a requirement of decrypting data and if they want to see it, as I've rightly mentioned, if you see the entire logs or entire request wherein some fields are masking, that is for the security purpose. Ahead of going in the journey, we do not have such a requirement wherein a client or a developer wants to see the unmasking now. No. They already know what are the values. but just for the security purpose, they are making it star, star, star. For example, anywhere, if you're trying to put your password on any site, how does it happen? From backend, you are adding a normal password, right? But it is designed in such a way that people, it is visible as a star, star, star.
Yeah, this mask function is basically used to mask your original data with something else. That's it.
Yes.
It can be star, it can be any special character, it can
any
be
any special character. Yes, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Also, like if you have a requirement, like, you know, like like Superia is saying, like password, it can be masked from a star. And like if you have a requirement that in the output, instead of password, I need authentication header or authentication secret key, I would say. So you can just write password with secret key. So password will get replaced with the secret key. As well. So it's just like replace function in the database, just
exactly
replace function. Nothing more. Yeah.
Oh, yes, I think, this is something, I think we are done. Thank you so much.
Yes, thanks, Supriya. I really appreciate the way people have presented. And this is not the end of the contribution from you guys. But still, yeah, we are looking forward. Anyway, I have one question from Safi. I see he's quite active guy. I have seen this guy in a couple of meetup. He's asking continuously some question, very good question that will helpful for the community. So again, I can see some question from Safi. May I know application slash JSON application data, will it work similarly? Why we have a application data? Okay. So, so these both are different application data, DW and application JSON. So if you see the application JSON, the key will have a double quote. Okay. And in slash DW, you will not get any double quote in the key, I would say. And slash DW is an internal language, internal meme type for the database engine. This is not used for the real life coding. This is only used to validate the database function, whether the function is correctly parsed or not based on the function. So this is something that, you know, it's not used in real life. That is only for to understand the function which you have written is correct or not. So just to validate the, you know, all the stuff.
Yeah.
So in the key, you will not see any double quote of in the string. But while transforming to JSON, you will see a double quote in the key. So just a validation of the function, whichever the function you are writing in database, whether everything is parsing correctly or not. If you want to check, you can go for the DW, else you can go for the applications like JSON and XML. That's all. Yeah, thanks, Happy. I really appreciate the way you people are asking the question, especially you. I have seen you in couple.
And even I have to say thanks. Thanks for showing interest, people. You're asking question that indicates that throughout your, you know, listening, and I hope it is helpful for you.
And Dignesh also, these people are quite impressive.
I've seen Venu, beginning. Yep.
Yeah. So, Sudeshna, Akshita, anyone there?
Yeah.
I'm not sure what are the next.
We can pick up the second question.
There's some background noise, actually. I don't know where from it's coming.
Okay.
So, Sumit, actually, Akshata is saying that can you go for the another question? One was
quiz
pending
question
from Ramil. Yeah, the quiz question.
Yeah. Okay.
So, wait, Sumit. Let everyone be ready. Akshata.
Akshata is pinging something.
Yes.
I think... before you, second quiz time has come, Sumit.
Wait. Chef is also asking about the recordings and PPT.
Recording and PPT.
I'll be sharing the recording and PPT soon. I will just mail you guys the link where basically the meetup page, right, where you have registered, there only you will find it uploaded. The same link. This is the link where you'll find it. Okay, I'll upload it in soon.
And recording will be available once the session is over. So it's still in the process of recording.
Yeah.
Sumit, your question?
Is it good to go now? Can I ask?
Yes, you can ask.
Okay, so the question, quiz question from RAML topic will be, I have covered some HTTP codes session, like there were 1xx, 2xx, all these HTTP codes. So the RAML question, quiz question will be, what will be the difference between 4xx and 5xx? In what scenario we are getting 4xx related errors, and in what scenario we are getting 5xx related errors?
Hey Sumit, yeah, thanks for that question. Yeah, this is Venu. Okay, so just now I type my answer. So basically 4xx is something like, let's say you have some, you are trying to create some order. Okay, the associated customer is not there. So that's a kind of data issue. Okay, that is a kind of bad request. So either you generate from the MuleSoft, or N system has some kind of standard that will give you. Or be it iteration or forbidden, or you know, too many requests or data conflicts. So these are 4xx when it comes to client errors, sorry, server errors. By default, let's say data you got failed, or you know, I mean, whatever the error MuleSoft is not able to realize, you know, that is going to give you 500. Then there is a gateway related error, be it bad gateway or you know, gateway timeout when your request is taking more time. And if your application is not responding, that's a bad gateway. So yeah, that's a server and client.
Are you Vigneshwaram who's answering?
No, this is Venu. Venu.
Venu. Venu. Yeah. Venu. He told us name in Malaysia.
Who's this person who has dropped the answer also a minute ago?
Venu, Vigneshwar, Apurva. There are a lot of answers we have got.
Rishabh also has a correct answer, I can see.
Yes, Manish have put down the names. So the first three are actually Venu, Purva, Shweta, they are already there in the first quiz names.
Yeah, I think. But you can include Apurva also, because she has given the short answer for HTTP 4xx client and server.
Yeah.
So Apurva, yeah. Venu, Shweta, I think you have already included. Ganesh, you have already included.
Yeah, Apurva is already there, a part of like first quiz question, so we won't duplicate it. We'll give chance to others as well.
Yes, that's right.
I'm noting on the name, I'll post in the group in some time. Sumit, maybe you can. So, Rishna, even you're noting down, right? We'll just compare it out.
Yeah, I'll send it over to you.
Yeah,
okay.
Sumit, you can take up with the just a minute question. I'll write it down. Third, okay. So, yeah.
Would you like to take this next question for data view, or should I take it?
Okay, data view, from what I have heard, definitely. So guys, be ready. This is the another question for data view, what Sumit has explained, and we have had a good discussion on that topic. So I want to understand the difference between the tech function and a drop function. Shweta, take kits, drop removes.
Take will take and drop will drop.
This is a good answer. So,
drop error name, guess.
Given by Abhinav, actually.
I think Shweta, we don't need to include. She is already there. Vigneshwaram, take extract. Vignesh.
And he has another answer. I think he has entered. Take extracts and drop removes partial chats from. Take will show the values and drop will drop. Aman Jain.
Yeah, Harshit, Purva, Dhanasri. These people are correct.
Vigneshwaran again. Suresh Patra.
I think Apurva we have already added. Apurva has taken effort also. Already.
I can see Aman has answered. Harshit, these are the new.
Harshit, Dhanasri. There is another.
Yep. Dhanasri is okay.
Yes, Dhanasri, Harshit, and two. Who else?
Vigneshwaram, Dhanashri,
Harshit.
Okay, I'm posting down the name.
Why don't you can share the screen, Akshita?
Yes, I'll share my screen. Can you see?
No, I can't see your screen. Yeah, I can see now. Mm-hmm.
So anyone else to add the third one, third question?
Harshit Gupta. Harshit Gupta is there. Third. Uh-huh. Suresh Patra. Uh-huh. Yes. Third drop remove.
So I can transpin the one now.
Aman Jain, in the third you can include Aman Jain. Yeah, that's all.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I could not say my name in the second. I answered first on the second question.
Yeah.
Please check.
Venu, I think first for your name.
You are there for the first one. Actually, we can remove anybody who's extra, like Harshit. I think.
I've removed anyone meeting.
We've added Harshit and all the three.
Is it?
Yeah, Harshit is in all three. So I can keep him on the in the last.
Yeah. Yes.
So good guys for this, man.
Anyone else who's repeating?
Guys,
yeah, Ganesh is repeating actually. Yeah. You need to write some, you know, distinct by field.
Distinct by function.
Correct. Next time we'll try to do something.
So okay. I'll send the win.
So this is for which question?
This is question one. Yeah.
Okay, one. We'll go one by one.
Madhuri.
Okay, who is the lucky one?
It's Madhuri.
Wait, I'll take a picture.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Congratulations, Madhuri.
Congrats, Madhuri.
Congrats.
Don't forget to share your feedback over the LinkedIn.
Madhuri, you have your email ID. So please do share your email ID over chat.
And if someone is not there, please cancel the winner part also.
Madhuri
is there? Is she there? Please check so the
mother. This is the one for second.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'll spend the
money. Okay.
It's in there already. You're there?
Who it is?
Kinera Red.
You will get that hair straightener which is there now on the left.
Yes.
Very good hair straightener. You can take it and give it to me.
Yeah, Akshita, I'm
done. So we come to the third one.
Third one, I am expecting first two
names. Dhanashree. Congrats,
Dhanashree. Yes. See the mic, see my guest.
Sorry?
Taking the picture, Sudesh.
No, 1 minute. Can we just confirm if we have all the three
winners? If not, then we'll have only one or two, okay? So this is something that Sudeshna, you have to take on priority at least.
Okay, just send us your IDs. And Sudeshna, maybe you can share your screen now.
You can share too, no problem. For the last part, yeah.
For the last,
you already have it shared.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, I've stopped sharing. Sorry.
We can continue.
Okay, you're saying to continue. Fine.
Yes, yeah. You continue.
I need to go to the last one.
So we need your email ID, as we just said, for you forget.
So you all can nominate yourself for the next meetup if you're willing to be a speaker, if you have a good topic or content, or if you're interested, even we can help you out in choosing the topic and also the content if you want. So do nominate yourself and you get a free training and certification voucher if you're volunteering yourself as a speaker. So next thing is, like, we have so many pictures will be sharing over group. Even if you have taken, you all can share it over LinkedIn, Twitter, Instagram, everywhere. And you can just use this hashtag to tweet. Okay, MuseOff Meetups. And you can tag us, me, Sudeshna, Manish. Everyone, you can follow us on LinkedIn as well. And there is a Telegram group, like the link which I'll be sharing. So maybe you can share this link on the chat section. So people can join, like whoever is new, can join the group on Telegram. Or like we have a WhatsApp group too, but it's full. That's why we have opted for Telegram group. So we keep posting important updates, the community updates and the meetup related updates over here in this group. So, and also it's like an interactive platform wherein if you have any doubts and all, there are other people from community who helps you out with everything, with solution, with feedbacks. And all. So yeah. So the next is introduce. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead. Yeah.
Yeah. So the networking time, like normally during the offline meetups, we do have a great networking time, but this like during the online, we can have it as well. Like you all can introduce yourself if you want to say something or there's a feedback for us for the next meetup. And after this session gets over, the meetup gets over, you will be getting a feedback mail. So do fill out the form, the feedback, if you have suggestions for us. The feedback is very important for us. Like that's how we grow up further, right? So if anyone would say anything, you all can. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And thank you for joining us today.
Yeah, but we can see only one email ID from the beginner. So this is something that, not acceptable, I would say. Might be.
Okay.
We have selected three beginner, right, for quiz, correct?
Yes.
Kinara Reddy is one. Dhanasiri, I can see. She has given. He or she, I don't know.
Okay. And there is one Madhur.
Madhuri. So these two people are not there. So let's consider one and we'll discuss offline this. So this
okay, fine.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So maybe just you can are you sure Dhanashri and all are not there? Because she was there since like
No, Kinara is there. She is there.
Kinara and Madhuri, she is not there.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Fine, then we'll consider it as one.
Yeah. We'll consider Dhanashri only this time. This is something not acceptable, people are doing for the community and people are not.
We can take a group maybe with Dhanashri and
So Dhanashri, you will be present. Please be available for 2 to 3 minutes next. Thank you guys.
Thank you all. Bye-bye.
Bye everyone.
Thank you, Purva.
Sudeshna, you can turn on your video, please.
Yes.
So, Dhanashri.